You look especially beautiful tonight, Miss Featherington.
You have done very well, Penelope.
What more could you want?
Hello, John, and welcome to the Awards Tour podcast. How are you today?
Great. How are you?
I'm doing great. I will go ahead and say I am so glad that we're finally able to talk about this season. I've been obsessed with it since they sent it over to my Netflix queue. But talk about joining this season and really the incredible stories that you knew were going to be on deck, because this, again, is a season that so many folks have been obsessed about and been thinking about for so long.
Actually, you know, in season one, I co-designed it with Ellen Morasnick. So we had started these characters. I didn't work on season two, so it was great to come back with a break because they've all matured. They've all gotten a little older. And I was so glad not to continue the same thing as season one and season two. It was a great challenge, or not a challenge, a great opportunity to change Penelope into a woman, you know, into a leading lady.
Did you know going into the season just how, you know, in your absence, but also more particularly just in general, folks were looking forward to this season? Because I think as a fan of the books, first of all, they're moving this one up from what would be the fourth book to the third season. So that's already, I think, sort of an idea where folks are like, right, we were chomping at the bit for this moment. Did you know that going in, that this was definitely going to be something that folks were going to be paying attention to, you know, all of the Pretty Woman, Cinderella type moments, anxiously waiting to see what you were going to do?
I have to say no. I know that it was an important step for the character. It was an important step for the books, but not until we actually started to work when we realized how important it was. Because if it is the basis for eight episodes, it has to be right. It has to be accepted and loved by the public. It has to be loved by the characters so that they can do their job, you know, and that started to weigh on us, not a lot, but, you know, it became important. This is why we are here. It was a large responsibility to, you know, to deal with.
And I want to talk about some of the other characters next, but I did want to particularly highlight one of the first look images that we got was Penelope sitting against the windowsill, sort of like looking out in that now what folks, when they watch the season, will know is a very hero dress for her. It's a very sort of not just like the glam moment, but her living in this new version of herself. I'd love for you to talk about that dress in particular and what was your approach to that one? Because it's not the Pretty Woman makeover moment. It's much more she's living in this new look. And I think that was the first inkling that folks had of like, oh, wow, like they did exactly what we wanted, more particularly, like the reaction to it was very, very good. But also it was understated in certain ways as well. Right. Like it felt lived in.
What you just said is exactly what we did. She's living in that look. The first time we see her in the green dress, she's making a statement and it's good for one moment. It makes a statement and then it's over. But we have to have eight episodes where she is on camera all the time. Her acting and her showing her character is something that we didn't want to get in the way of. And we just wanted to, she had to be beautiful because that's what people expected. But that beauty had to be, for her, confident, secure, and comfortable. So that's why you'll see all of her colors are softer, so that we really let her and the character shine through to tell the story. It's one of those cases where a costume designer can, I don't want to say step back, because you're not stepping back. You're making a conscious choice to not make a costume. Even though this is a fantasy world and the clothes are fantasy, what she's wearing is kind of real because the clothes don't wear her. She's wearing the clothes. She's the one who's in charge of what she's doing. That's why in that picture, she looks, even though she's reserved and relaxed, do you really remember what that dress is?
Yeah, I mean, it's a soft, and I'm going to like describe it differently than like the real color of it, but it feels almost like a soft, like bluish seafoam sort of color, and with the flowers on the lapel. And just like with her looking across the way, I assume that she was looking either for or towards where, you know, Colin would be. Yeah.
But I think that dress in the windowsill is actually kind of gold and
pink. Is it gold? Okay.
So you see blue, other people three, and that's what we also did. We layered fabric.
Oh, so I'm not crazy. I've like different people see different things. Okay, wow. Okay.
We layered. We didn't want to make, you know, people like love Easter eggs. So if we put her in a blue dress, they would say, "Oh, that's the Bridget." And we put it, it would be this. So we actually layered fabrics together: blue, green, pink, a little bit of yellow. So when you look at a dress, you're not really sure what color it is. And some dresses.
Wow.
There's a scene in the garden where she's talking to Colin at night. And if you look at the dress carefully, it's kind of yellowish. It's kind of gold. It's kind of green. It's got blue in it. It's all different colors. And that's one reason is so that we can't pinpoint where she's going. We
wow.
still want, and the audience or the, you know, the people that watch the show, you know, really read into it and try to figure things out because they love the books. They love the show. It's one place where we didn't want to help them along, which is not a nice thing, but it would wreck the story if you could tell what was happening through what she was wearing.
Yeah.
Also, that's incorporated into the whole look of the season was, use the word flower garden. It's like, when you look at a flower, it's many different colors. And that's how we tried to approach the season. That in the beginning, in season one and season two, the color palettes were much more obvious. But because the audience knows the actors now, they know the characters now, we felt a little more confident not to have to follow that color storyline. And plus their stories are maturing. They're physically maturing. So we thought the color palette could also mature.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely see that.
It's not like a Disney movie where the princess always wears blue, you know, we've mixed up the color palette quite a lot.
Yeah, just thinking about some of her key looks to this one, whether it be that green one compared to the one that I'm speaking of, to some of the later ones as things sort of progress. But I want to talk about another couple of characters before we go back to Penelope and Colin and we get into a little bit more of their story told through Close in the Romance, is the Kate and Anthony of it all. They also, I think, are telling a very interesting story. I mean, Kate is now officially the Viscountess of Bridgerton, and she very much looks that in season three. And I know you didn't work on season two, and so you really got to almost treat this like a brand new character as far as how you were dealing with it. And then with Anthony, there was always a regality to what he was wearing in both season one and season two, but there's almost like a comfortableness and a calm that you can see play out in some of his clothes based on the fact that Kate's now in his life. Like, he seems calmer, both in not just his demeanor, yes, but also the way he presents. I'd love for you to talk a little bit about telling their story in season three, because they're a very big part of it as well.
Yeah, and we took all that into account. And it's really, for us, Dougie, who works with me, takes care of the men's tailoring side, and George, who's a woman, helps me with the women's side. And because Kate and Anthony, they're not new characters, but they've gone to India, so we approached, just like you said, that they were coming back as new characters. She no longer has to prove anything. She's the Viscountess. She's married. He's married. So we actually took his fabrics and used velvets, and that's why it appears that he's more comfortable and softer, because his clothes are actually more soft and more comfortable. She, instead of the brighter colors that you saw before, we've gone to a more natural color palette, a darker color palette, and brought in Indian influences, not in like so much as jewelry and embroidery, but in the silhouette. So it's more, she is a person that is like a, it's like an abstract painting to me. She's shape and form.
One thing I also noticed too with her is she does feel a little bit more like those Indian influences and how they look against somebody like the Dowager Viscountess and like some of the other members of the Ton. Like, she very much does feel like an Indian princess now existing in this world, more so than I think she did season
two. Which is what we did, because we actually took the Empire line and blended it with a sari. So it's a slightly different look. It's a different sleeve, and it's subtle, but it works. And again, it's part of her. And also, like I said before, when you're in a fitting and we all look at something and it's different than what they've had before, but they've been traveling. So it's got history to it, but it's different, and it's just it just becomes part of them. You don't really, like, what color are her clothes?
So hers, I was, oh, this is probably another trick question, but I saw it as like this soft turquoise purple color mixed with a little bit of gold, but then there's like a sheerness to it because it's almost like with those like ropes, the way that it sort of hangs like that. But then I could be wrong. You're going to tell me that it's green now.
No, it's actually black and white plaid.
Really? What?
No.
What? No. Okay. You are so good at this deadpan, sir. You're killing me.
But that's what we wanted to achieve. Again, I think she looks beautiful. I think you agree that she looks beautiful. She looks natural. And that's what we tried to achieve. We wanted her to come through. We wanted, it sounds so corny, but it's Bridgerton. They have to look beautiful. They have to be interesting for the audience. They have to be a surprise for the audience. The clothes, they can help tell the story because what she's wearing looks like it's from India. So, you know, they've been to India. At the same time, it cannot overpower them.
No. You know? And then again, there's still, you know, supporting characters. I want to get to two more before we get back to Penelope and Colin. And one is the person who is in her own world in a lot of ways, and that is the queen. And even though she is, you know, I always feel like she is the thing that is sort of the heartbeat of the audience. She's a lot of times saying what we want to say as far as what Listledown is doing with other people. Like, y'all need to get together, all of that. Her looks this season, I also found them to be even more elaborate, like from the head down. Like, she has more elaborate wigs. She has more elaborate dresses. Like, she is so the queen, it feels like. And even though there's parts of this season where she feels a little bit on her back foot, there is even more regality to what she does. And I feel like with her, I don't know, I think like she'd be kind of a dream because you get to play with an entirely different time frame because she's still wearing former empire looks. And so it's almost like, you know, you just put Marie Antoinette in the middle of this Regency world.
Right. And for us, this is one place where in the previous seasons, her clothing or her fabrication was much more real, more period. And we're talking about like a flower garden. To us, again, she was a large flower. I mean, she's like a centerpiece. So you want the bees to be flying around her. And so it was a lot of incorporating with Erica, the hair designer, her looks. But we really were unrigid in what we used as far as fabrication, because it's all modern fabric mixed with old fabric. But an embellishment department, which are like, to me, are like painters. You know, they, all of them are just layers and layers of different textures and fabrics and colors. And because she is the queen, she is one that we could go further than anybody else, because no one in the ton will question what she's wearing. So I think you also see focus to her because we make sure that whatever she's wearing as color-wise and everything, there's nothing else around her like that, you know. And we also, because of her character, this is one place where we differ a little bit on, instead of, she is such a strong person in history. We know who she is. She's a strong person in real life. She's a strong character. She's a strong actress. So we could push her clothes a little further than everyone else, because she can, even if we did too much, she would overpower it. You know, nothing's going to knock her down.
Absolutely. There's one last person I also wanted to talk about who folks are going to get to know a little bit better this season, and that is Francesca. And I think she, very similarly to how the queen is separate from the rest of the ton, she is separate from the rest of the Bridgertons, where they were all born to stand out. She very much likes to be a little bit further to the side. And I loved how her clothes, I think, reflected that, like her modesty and her quietness, even from, you know, the actress who plays her is obviously gorgeous, but it's almost like she's fighting, even in the costuming and everything that she does, to make herself less memorable, less like the typical Bridgerton. So I'd love to talk about how you felt dressing Francesca this year.
Well, you're absolutely right, because we have to remember there's two things that we had. One is that she's a new actress for the role, so we didn't want to try to mimic the last look or the last person. We wanted it to be herself. And well, we know the character. The audience doesn't know as much as we do, but we wanted her to be just beautiful and nothing to give away who she is. The only thing that we did do was You notice she has lots of sheer sleeves. She's very translucent. And that's to make her exactly what you said. She's like a little mysterious. She's mysterious. And we've used translucency in a lot of things, but if she wears translucent gloves, so it's like, is she wearing a glove? Isn't she wearing a glove? Is that, again, what color is that dress? But she's demure, but she herself is so gorgeous that there's nothing we could do to enhance her. So let's just let her do it for us. And we also used on her a lot of texture. We kept thinking about, this is a terrible thing to say, pollen, because we can't, you know, pollen is, you know, but we thought of a flower garden, like that the fluff that flies around in the air is kind of where she came from.
Oh, wow. The thing I really want to talk about, and book fans would be mad if I didn't, is that dress and just how gorgeous it is in the carriage ride moment. I feel like with those drops of gold, it really does feel like almost like gold raindrops on her. And to me, it looks like it's in that soft Bridgerton blue. I love the way they lit that. Talk about how you set that up with the other principal stakeholders, because that really was a dance of like all the departments, hair, makeup, production design, lighting, director, all of them, actors getting together. So how did y'all approach that? And was that something that you knew like early on, okay, we gotta spend some time on this one?
We knew we had to spend some time on it, and we knew the importance of it. And it was a little, that was one of the more technical dresses, even though it doesn't look like it, because she had to dance in it. She had to be in the carriage. Colin had to be able to move the fabric around. So
a little bit. Most
dresses, yeah. And most dresses, there's more structure to them. There's more layers of petticoats. And this is one place where we used fabrics that were soft and silky so that it could move up easily. And it could also have enough weight to drop down easily. It's like the reason why the dress is actually pale green, not blue.
Oh my gosh, see?
I know, yeah. And it is gold, but if you notice the gold is heavier down at the bottom, that actually adds weight so that when he pushes the skirt up, it drops down. You know, it's got some technical things thought about into it so that it helps with their choreography, their movement. And it had to be something that, I don't want to say sparkled, but it had to have light. And because they're inside of the carriage, it had to, we didn't want her to go into a shadow. It had to be like a light, you know, like the sun. Yeah. I don't know. And it's such an important moment for them that it had to be not a glorious dress, but it had to give you a glorious feeling, you know, of light and, yeah.
No, that's perfect. And then her scene partner and in that one.
Yeah, that's one dress, if you look at it, that has no fluff on it, no flowers. It's just the dress and her body and her shape. It's like think of her like she's in your brain, because none of that exists. She's kind of nude.
Oh, I love it. Her scene partner in that one, Colin, he also gets a bit of glow up this season. I do think that folks sometimes forget that because there's so much focus on Penelope. And I'd love for you to talk a little bit about, because he really does come back looking the dashing gentleman, which is a complete departure from the Colin that we meet in season one and see in parts of season two.
Yeah, in season two, he's definitely a boy. He's definitely showing us he's a Bridgerton in the light blue colors and the light gray and all the patterns and florals and things. And it's just that they both matured in the story, and they both matured physically themselves. They're older people, and he's been away on a trip. And he's learned a lot of knowledge, he's experienced a lot of things. And we really thought, sounds very sexist, but what does a young woman want to see walk off that boat? They want to see a guy that's a little dirty, maybe a little shaven. He's been in the bottom, he's aged. He's got to have mystery. They want to know where he's been, what he's been walking around, what he's seen, what he's doing, what he smells like, you know, what his breath smells like. And because Penelope has now become more refined, we've taken him a little more rugged. And we actually, our inspiration for him was, we're not supposed to smoke, but the Marlboro Man, a guy that's on a horse that's a little dusty. He just sailed into town, you know. And what they remember each other to be has to be the opposite of, you know, when they meet again visually, so that they really have to dig into who they are again. If he'd gotten off the boat in a blue coat and pants, it would have been, yeah, so what, you know, big deal. But it's just something for her now to investigate, and for him, you know, to investigate who she really is again. Because visually, they're different people. Yeah.
We have to get out of here, but I think I would also have to say, maybe it's like picking your kids, but do you have a favorite outfit from the season as my last question?
The hair designer who works with me, she taught me this answer, and it's true. The favorite costume is the costume that you're working on at the moment, because that's where your focus is. And I always say that it's a favorite costume is when it's on the actor in the scene doing what it's supposed to do. When it comes off and it's on the hanger, there is, you know, it's like each one has something special to us. But
that's a good one.
It sounds so great that they're like children. You know, you can't have a favorite one because they all have different stories to tell and different, you know, how they were made and how they were conceived. And talk about Jesus in a minute. No,
no, we're good. John, it was really great talking to you about all the costumes this season. I can't wait for folks to take a look at it. They're going to die.
That's nice to hear. Great.
All right. Well, thank you very much.